I've been waiting a long time for this.
Captain America Civil War is now the number one movie in the world.
Okay, tiny dude is big now.
Hey, what's going on, everyone? It's Brendan Keith Avian. I want to welcome you to Just My Opinion Reviews, where today we're going to discuss my spoiler-filled review for Captain America Civil War. If you've already seen my non-spoiler review, you know how I feel about this film. I loved it, but I couldn't talk about spoilers, but I can talk about it now. Got my Captain America uniform on, got my background, got my notes that I made because I want to talk everything. And yes, you did hear me correctly. I did say spoilers. So if you have not seen Captain America Civil War yet, what are you doing with your life? The movie is freaking amazing. Stop this video. Go see it two or three times. Come back. If you have any questions, hopefully I will answer them for you. So I'm going to be talking spoilers up, down, left, right, in and out, as if you've already seen the movie. You have been warned. My name is Brendan Keith Avery, and this is just my spoilery opinion. Alright guys, welcome back to this spoiler-filled review of Captain America Civil War. I got my notes right here. I'm going to literally try to talk about absolutely everything that I can, starting off just at the beginning. And I'm going to start off with some things that I did not like towards the beginning. And it didn't annoy me at first, but they kept doing it throughout the films. And overall, I love this film. My non-spoiler review, I gave it a 9.5. I've seen this twice now. Right now, as I'm recording this, is Friday evening, about 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. And I want to leave it at the 9.5. But if you've seen the film, you know it starts off, looks like they're in like Alaska or Antarctica or somewhere. And it's just a nothing but a barren wasteland of ice and snow. And we get to see where Bucky Barnes, the Winter Soldier, is being held captive. And this is taking place in the early 90s and 1991. And when I was talking about some things that I didn't like, it didn't bother me at first. But the big giant subtitles that went across the screen, 1991, about the second or third time they did that, I was just like, okay, stop. What are you doing? But anyway, besides that, we get to go and see Winter Soldier in this secret hidden base, and the guy is punching in the code, and there's a few henchmen in there, and they're reading this red book with a star on it, which, you know, if you read the comics, that's from Winter Soldier's backstory. And it's just about 10 or 15 random words that they say, like freight car and homecoming and 1 and 17 and just a few other just random words, and they've been brainwashing the hell out of Bucky Barnes. And when you say these words in a certain cadence and a certain tone and a certain order, you know, the Winter Soldier will do whatever, you know, you want him to do. And I like that. I like how they set that up. That was pretty cool. You know, I like the backstory with that they're giving us with Winter Soldier. That was really cool. I like that. That was getting me on board with the character more than I already was. Now, the next scene takes place in Logos, Africa. And this is part of where they started showing you in the trailers and some of the clips where Captain America is taking on Crossbones and some other henchmen. And let me pause there and just say this. When I saw this movie, I saw the first trailer, I saw the second trailer, and then I saw the Super Bowl spot. I didn't watch any more. No, and I also did see the clip that they released at the MTV Awards. So I went in this completely fresh. I didn't want to watch any more TV spots. I didn't want to watch any more clips. I just did not want to ruin the movie for myself. But if you watch a clip, I mean, that can just some, you know, take away from the overall experience. You know, you can still enjoy it, but that's just taking away a, oh my gosh, moment. And even though I did see that clip, at the MTV, I wasn't at the MTV Awards, on TV, I was still blown away from that scene, because we get Cap, you know, and Scarlet Witch, she's just trying to learn her abilities, and Black Widow's talking to her while they're eating, not eating, but drinking coffee or pretending like they're drinking at the cafe, and Black Widow's saying like, hey, you know, looking over your shoulder needs to become second nature, and you can tell us that Scarlet Witch is not really used to this type of role, you know, as a secret agent trying to, you know, scope the scene out and all that good stuff. But, you know, she's learning how to use her powers more, which I will talk about later. But then you get to, you know, you get to see Falcon with his red wing attachment on the back of his wingsuit. And, you know, I in the comics and back in the day, it was actually a real bird. But, you know, I don't know, that may look kind of silly in a 2016 live action, you know, adaptation. But, you know, it's robotic and it can scan stuff. And, you know, I like that. It's, you know, basically a drone. I think that's pretty cool. You know, I like that a lot. And what I love is how he had Red Wing go under the truck that Bucky Barnes, Crossbones, you know, had his henchman driving, and it's full weight to capacity, and they run. It's a battering ram, and they run over the base, and then they have their two big trucks going there, and they're just emptying the clip, just spraying everybody down, just then shooting gas canisters all into the infectious disease center. And I'm on board. I mean, I'm like, you know, man, the movie's starting out. It's great action. I'm on board. I am loving all of this. And as you see, we get Captain Merck. He comes down, and he knocks the guy out with his shield, then kicks the truck and knocks that guy over there. And you've seen that in that clip. But what I like about what makes movies like this good, when you have so many characters with so many abilities, when you have plot within the action, and you have, you know, a nice written out story of why characters can do certain things. And the reason why I said it is, if you've seen the movie, Scarlet Witch is extremely powerful. During that whole scene, she could have just showed up immediately and flew into the building herself and did her magical powers. No, it's not magic, like probability and telekinesis and all that, but I get telekinesis and telepathy mixed up. You know, help me out in the comments. But she could just go in there and do all of that. But they wrote, the Russo brothers wrote, and the writers wrote plot within the action, because since they fired canisters into the building, she that makes her occupied. So, you know, Falcon is doing his thing. Scarlet Witch is busy trying to get, using her powers to try to get the gas out of the building. And then Captain America is in there. And I like how she used her powers to throw him in there. That was real cool. I love that, how they're teaming up. But I just like to where they actually gave you a reason, written plot within the action, as to why Scarlet Witch could not go in there and just wreck shop. Because, you know, if she could do that, it would be no contest and the action scene would probably be boring. But, you know, they gave her something to do. Something else that I just love so much is that Falcon has turned his wings into shields. And that is just so clean, to where, I mean, he could do one shield like this while he's shooting, and switch it like this. He can have both wings as shield. He even did something to where he turned around and made the wings fly up behind him. And he did something on his little watch and made two little missiles fly up in the air and then come down to it. Because, you know, he didn't want to waste time. You know, the henchmen are there behind their trucks over here shooting, and he's behind this truck over here. He's like, okay, this is not working. Let me do this. Shield myself. Bloop, bloop, bloop. Missiles go up, blow them straight to hell. I love that. I mean, that's amazing. I mean, that's just great, great action. I love that. And then next we get Black Widow in there just beating the hell out of everybody. I mean, shit, they stepped her game up to like 15-11. 15-11. What you get? You get the idea. But I mean, she's riding on her motorcycle full speed, and she uses the momentum and just jumps off the motorcycle and flings the motorcycle into like one or two guys, and then she jumps in. I mean, I really do love how much do all these films, they are making her grow and just more and more powerful. I mean, she is a strong female character with no abilities, and she's beating ass with all this hand-to-hand combat and sweeping legs and flipping over here and jumping and grabbing a gun. I mean, She held her own. I mean, she was beating up these henchmen one by one by one by one. But then they want to throw crossbones in there. And, you know, he had all that armor on. And she tried to hit him in the neck with her little electrical device. He's like, that don't work on me no more. And so he, like, knocks her out and throws her into the truck and throws a grenade in there. And I'm like, damn, how is she finna get out of this? But she uses her brain and her wits. Very quickly throws one guy on top of the grenade and then puts the other guy in between her and the grenade, and she gets out of there. And I just love that. I mean, that is just, you know, amazing action and plot within the action, and I'm entertained and I'm just loving every bit of that. But then the crap hits the fan with the big explosion going off, because Crossbones had the bomb vest on his chest. And I really do like that Cap is so focused, and that Cap versus Crossbones fight scene or whatever, that was lovely hand-to-hand too. And then as soon as Crossbones says Bucky, Cap loses his concentration, and Crossbones sets off the bomb, and, you know, Scarlet Witch has to come over there. And I wasn't expecting to do that. I'm like, damn, I know Cap's not going to die, but I'm like, whoa. As soon as the explosion went off, I was like, whoa, but Scarlet Witch comes over there and uses her powers. And she's more experienced than Age of Ultron, but she flings the thing up into the building and it blows up. And I'm just like, damn, this really sucks. Some people in there, all of them died. And we found out later that it was a few people, and at least 11 people from Africans from Wakanda or whatever. And I'm just like, man, you know, I mean, that is kind of Scarlet. Well, it's not her fault. I mean, it is her fault, but it's not her fault. But, you know, people looking on the outside in, they don't know that. And I'm just like, wow, you know, this is really coming together as far as the story is concerned. I can really see why people are like, okay, these Avengers need to be checked. I mean, they were based over here in America, and now they're over here all the way in Lagos. And who gives, you know, you jurisdiction to do this? I mean, come on. This has to stop. And it's just building on that valid reason of to why the Avengers actually do need to be checked. And by the way, you know, I am Team Cap, but I'll talk about, you know, how I was leaning over to Iron Man a bit later. But I was just sitting there like, man, these people died. And, you know, that's pretty much it for that scene. Now, the next scene right here is, I really didn't care for this scene. And at this point, right after that scene, this is kind of to where things got boring for me. But they did pick up two or three scenes later, and I will tell you the exact point where they picked up. But when Tony Stark was doing memorizing, when he was reminiscing during the display, the presentation at MIT, and they were just showing him, you know, he made that device. It was like $615 million to where you can relive past events. I don't know why that scene just didn't do anything for me when he was on stage talking to the students with, you know, and giving out the grant. You know, that didn't do much for me then either. I don't know why. I guess just seeing Tony Stark at a young age, that just threw me off. I don't know. I just was not really engaged in that scene. But then right after that, you know, he meets, I forget her name, but the black lady that, you know, pinned the picture of her dead son on the chest of Tony Stark in Sokovia. That was very necessary for Tony to have an argument in this film. And, you know, the second time I saw it, I was really just like, man, okay, I really understand. I mean, that just sucks. Some woman comes to you and just says, hey, thanks a lot for killing my son. For not giving a crap about collateral damage, you guys dropped the building on him. You know, thanks. You know, he was great. He was going to be doing this and doing that, and now my son is dead. The best thing I've done in my life, you took that away from me. I mean, she didn't say those exact words, but that's the point that she was trying to convey. And I can understand how Tony is just like, you know, man, we gotta do something. Something has got to give as to why, you know, if we're going to be, you know, doing Avengers, continue to be Avengers or not. Now, right after that, I didn't like this scene either. And this may be right after that, what was the scene with Zemo. And I'll talk about him later. But next, we get to see General Thaddeus Thunderbolt Ross from the 2008 Incredible Hulk. And they use different takes from the trailers that they actually put in the movie where he's talking about the Sokovia Accords. And I don't know. I didn't like that scene. It just kind of sucked, and I was boring. I mean, he's talking about playing golf and how his back was broken, or not his back was broken. How he hurt his back, and just the way he was talking to the Avengers, I don't know. I wasn't buying it. I just really didn't care for it. It just really wasn't doing anything for me. And I was just, maybe I was just wanting something more. But, you know, that scene was over. And then we finally get the next scene to where I didn't like the beginning of it, but I liked the end. And just the way Tony Stark was giving his dialogue to the rest of the Avengers when they are trying to decide if they should sign a COVID course or not. Well, first, Tony was being quiet and they called him out on that. But then when Tony goes to the kitchen and, you know, he's like, oh, yeah, by the way, this guy here is so-and-so, so-and-so. And you know, while the Avengers are doing things and we're over there just kicking ass. And I just didn't like that dialogue. But then right after that, when he comes back over to the group of people, like Cap and Vision and Falcon and War Machine and all of them, that's where it picked back up for me. And they actually showed that clip online, and I saw that after the fact, and after I saw it the first time, and I really did, you know, like that scene, and that's where things picked back up for me, and starting with the second part of that scene, because you had Falcon calling out Black Widow, just like, hey, didn't like 3 years ago, or 2 years ago, or he said a few years ago, weren't you mouthing off at the government, now you want to be on their side, and then Vision puts his two cents in, and then, like, you know, Tony's putting his two cents in, it's like, hey, you know, they have an agenda. And he's like, well, that's great. You know, when I found out that my weapons were being used for evil, I put a stop to it. And Cap was like, hey, well, you chose that. I mean, I'm loving all of that. And something else that I liked is, if you notice, and I was paying attention and doing the math in my head while the movie was going on, is that, and Kevin Feige, he's the president of Marvel right now. He doesn't have to report to Ike Perlman anymore. He can report to Alan Horn, the guy at Disney. But he said in an interview a long time ago is that the timeline in the movie is real life with real world. Because during this scene, Vision was like 8 years ago when Tony Stark revealed himself as Iron Man, blah, 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 blah. Well, okay, well, it's 2016, so 8 years ago, that's when the movie came out. And when Falcon said to Scarlet Witch, hey, wasn't it a few years ago when you mouthed off to the government and now you want to be on that side? That was 2 years ago, because Captain America Winter Soldier came out April of 2014, and this is 2 years later. So I really do like that. They did a great job there. But then Cap, he gets the text message that, you know, Peggy Carter died in her sleep, and he has to go to the funeral in the UK or overseas somewhere, Britain, or I forgot. But he has to go to the funeral. And, you know, that was really sad. And then we find out that Sharon Carter is actually the granddaughter of Peggy. Now, we already knew that as an audience member, or if you, you know, follow the story or the comics, or, you know, you check out a lot of the behind the scenes. But Cap and Falcon didn't know that. And I also like that Falcon was there, you know, to show support. You know, he doesn't really know Peggy, but that's his boy. He's trying to show support. And I also like that Black Widow came too, because she wants to show support either. And Captain America, you know, after the funeral, just like, hey, why are you here? And I forgot why. Oh, she said that, hey, I don't want you to be alone. And I like that. I really do like that. But then the next scene that we get is Vienna. And this is where the Sokovia Accords, where the United Nations, all 117 countries, want them to sign their course, and we get to see T'Chaka and T'Challa for the first time. I don't know who T'Chaka was, but T'Challa chat with Boseman. That was the first time we see him, and as soon as we see him with that Wakandan accent, I was like, man, I'm loving this guy already. He is just soaking up everything about this Black Panther role, and I was just getting excited. Now, if you saw my non-spoilery review, you saw that I loved everything about Black Panther, but I did not like the casting of... I said I didn't like something about the Black Panther lore. And what I did not like about it was the casting of T'Chaka. Because I wanted T'Chaka to look like he could beat ass too, but he didn't look like it. He looked like he probably could 30 years ago and he was retiring, and maybe he was sitting on the couch eating donuts and got fat or something. Maybe he wasn't fat. I mean, they only showed him from about here and up, but he just did not look like an imposing, threatening king to me. Now, he could not, because the Black Panther doesn't necessarily mean that you're king. It just means that you are the best warrior of that nation. I mean, you can wear both titles, and, you know, they change it up here and there through the comics. But I just wasn't really happy with the casting of T'Chaka No big deal. I mean, he died. He died when T'Challa was a boy in the comics. I mean, he dies at different times throughout the comics, you know, every time they try to change up the story. But then right after that, Zemo blows up the news van outside and T'Chaka dies. And then we get to see T'Challa chat with Bozeman and Black Panther, all frustrated and pissed off and not knowing what to do. He is just lost. He does not know what to do other than I need to find this guy and kill him. And Black Widow is trying to console him, like, hey, I'm sorry. You know, what can I do for you? And she's like, hey, you know, it is what it is. You know, my culture, you know, death is not the end. And my father felt this way. But I disagree. And I'm going to rip this guy's freaking throat out of his neck. And I was so excited and could not wait for him to do that. And what do you know? Bucky gets blamed for it, of course. And he is on the run and he has been in hiding for so long and they can't find him. But now they can find him. Everybody in the whole world is looking for him. And Cap got his little captain, got his cap on with his glasses, you know, just talking about, hey, you know, if I get involved, will you arrest me? Talking to Black Widow. She's like, man, no, I'm not going to arrest you, but you're going to make it worse. And, you know, Cap is a good dude. He wants to obey the law, but he's like, look, man, I know these guys. And Sharon tells him, like, hey, they're ready to shoot to kill. And she gives him information. And Falcon is like, hey, man, are you sure you want to do this? I just want to make sure we're weighing out all of our options. Because if they're shooting at you, they're shooting at me. And I like that because Cap is like, look, I can't just let them do this. Because if I am not there, my best friend is going to die. Like, I have nobody left in this world, literally. Peggy just died. He's my only friend. It's not his fault. So he has no choice but to get involved. And I like that. I mean, it's creating conflict within the story. And I'm loving every moment of it. And then what happens next? I love the fact that Cap finds Bucky first. And he's trying to talk to him. And you can tell that Bucky is just not really there. And Cap is just trying to be like straight up with him. Like, dude, man. Like, okay, we need to go on hiding. Like, you tripping. I know it's not your fault. But still, we gotta put some control on this. You know, what we're going to do. And Bucky's like, look, man, I don't do that anymore. And Cap's like, yeah, but they think you do. And they're finna come kill you. And then we get a badass action scene. They're throwing their flashbang grenades all through this. And I mean, like, Bucky is like flipping tables at the door and flipping mattresses and kicking over grenades to Cap so he can block you with the shit. I'm like, dude, how do you train your mind to think that fast? I mean, I'm just loving it. I mean, and then like Cap grabs the barrel of a gun once that busts through and flips it over here to twist the guy's arm like this. And then Bucky comes through with that kick. And Cap is like, you stop it. You're going to kill somebody. He's like, I'm not going to kill anybody. And punches the floor. And I'm thinking like, okay, Bucky is still crazy. He just tried to punch the crap out of Captain America. But he's like, no, there was like a backpack under there with his belongings. And I like how they tricked me with that. I like that. Then the chase goes on. And Bucky is beating all kinds of ass going down this stairwell. I mean, he's like throwing people into people, throwing rails, throwing guns at people, picking up cinder blocks. He's like has the door battering ram and beating people with the battering ram. Cap is beating people with his shit. I'm just like, oh my gosh. And the first time I saw this, during the scene watch, I loved it. There was, it wasn't registering me. It was a bit shaky cam. But the second time I seen it, I don't know if it's because, that has nothing to do with it. But I was able, it was just registering in my brain more. And I did not have that shaky cam effect that I had the first time. And I'm just loving it. And I love that Bucky, like, jumped down the corridor and then like a few of stories and then he grabs the rail because he has that powerful metal arm, but it still hurt him just a little bit. And I mean, I just like him using all of his abilities, you know, just to get away. And he is running away and he thinks he's in the clear until a shadowy figure comes over his head. And then his mother freaking Black Panther, you know, with his claws. And that was just such an epic pose, just an epic superhero landing. And I was just like, oh, I was loving it, loving it, loving it. I mean, he did not care. He ripped out those vibranium claws and he was trying to kill Bucky. And I don't blame him for that. I mean, the guy just saw his father get blown to smithereens and, you know, he thinks this is you. And I love that Black Panther freaking amazing with that vibranium suit. And it just looks so freaking great when he was about to kill him like this, and then the dumb helicopter comes and shooting him, and he's just looking like, man, what are you doing? You are really messing up my vengeance quest right now. Shoot me with these bullets, that's not gonna do nothing. Back up. You know, I mean, he didn't say that, but that's what I was, you know, thinking in my mind while I'm smiling and, you know, and giddy and all that. And, you know, Black Panther, he just had a hell of an interest, and I love every moment of it. But the fight is not over, and it turns into a foot chase with cars. And Bucky jumps down, Black Panther jumps down, and then Captain America is right after that, and Falcon comes even later. And this whole thing is lovely. I love the, you know, something that I loved is, you know, just, you know, this scene right here could have had a lot of room for people to nitpick and hate, like, huh, why don't they just use one of the cars and try to run? Well, yeah, that's exactly what Captain America did. He was like, look, why am I going to keep running? I know I'm superhuman, but I'm going to run out of breath. They're running 50 miles an hour. This Black Panther character is clearly faster than me, and I don't even know who he is right now. So there's a car behind him. He knocks the window out and gets in the car and starts driving, and then he catches up to Black Panther. Black Panther jumps in his car, and I like that. He's like, hey, Sam, I can't shake the dude. And Falcon comes in there with his big-ass wings, and he's still able to maneuver around. And, you know, something that I do want to see, and I hope they do address this in, I was going to say Avengers Infinity War, but we just found out that those titles are going to get changed. But I do want to know how the wings were Falcon made. Gosh, I do want to know how the wings that Falcon uses were made. Because in the comics, they were given to him by Black Panther. But so far, you see that they have no type of correlation at all. They don't know each other. So I guess we can throw that story point out the window. But I do want to know how his suit was being powered. He could have got it upgraded from Tony Stark. But, you know, he had that in Winter Soldier. But anyway, Falcon is coming in there. And Black Panther sees Falcon coming, so he does a Panther move and jumps off of a car and then jumps on the bottom of the Falcon, and he's not letting go. And he's, you know, flying all around, and he's getting close, and then to Bucky. And, oh, let me not leave that part out where Bucky uses his metal arm and grabs the motorcycle. Like, what? Every time I saw that scene, like, everybody was like, oh, shit, oh, fuck, oh. That's how it sounded in the theater, and I was along with it going like, the first time I seen it. The second time, I'm just like, yeah, uh-huh, and I knew it was coming, so, you know, I get enjoyment going to a big theater and seeing, hearing the reaction of everybody else, and when if I know it's coming, because I was lucky and saw it early, I'm just like, yeah, I know, that was nice, yeah, I thought so too, you know, I'm geeking out, but anyway, they keep going. And then Bucky throws the grenade or whatever, and Cap turns the vehicle. Oh, goodness gracious. Cap turns the vehicle sideways and starts running out the car and tackles Black Panther. And then he takes his mask off, and a War Machine comes there just like a boss, just like, everybody freeze, don't move, with his big cannons. And let me just talk about War Machine real quick. I'm so glad they upgraded him. And one of the reasons why, because within the MCU, there's 13 films now. Iron Man, you know that. Iron Man 2 is to me the worst. There's still some parts that I enjoy in the film, but Iron Man 2 is the worst out the whole MCU. Iron Man 3 is the second worst. Iron Man 3 is number 12. Iron Man 2 is number 13. Iron Man 3 is number 12. Do you realize that in Iron Man 3, War Machine, or the Iron Patriot, the fake one, he did not fire any weapons in his suit in one time. Not one time in the whole movie did he fire off his weapons. That really pissed me off. But they made up for that 10 times over in this. But anyway, War Machine comes down. Nobody moves. And then they get captured and they go to this secret base. And you learn that Zemo killed the doctor, and they're interrogating him. And I like his plan. I like that. We're still trying to find out, but he has that red book, Freight Train, Homecoming, 1:17. And Bucky's like, stop, Homecoming, 17, You know, I loved all of that. And then Bucky breaks out of there. Oh, let me back up. And because that was a nice scene. During this scene, and I think I have it correctly. Yes. But during this scene is when Tony comes over to Captain America and he gives him the pen. And they're talking. He's like, hey, this pen has been used for this, this, and this. And Captain was about to sign it. He was really about to sign it. I mean, it was making sense to him. Like, he didn't want to do it, but he understands that, you know, man, there has to be, you're not going to meet us in the middle somewhere, man. I mean, just, I mean, I'm Team Cap, and do I want them to be registered with the Sokovia Accords and in the comments of Superhero Registration Act? No. But at the same time, you cannot get mad at the rest of the world if they have a problem with people with that are enhanced that are just flying around the world doing whatever the hell they want. But anyway, Captain America, he's about to sign, and he's like, hey, there has to be some, I'm finna say appendages. That don't make no sense. Amendments or whatever. What did he say? I forgot. And he's like, oh, yeah, you know, we got the Duke of documents here, documents there. But then he says something about Scarlet Witch being trapped at the mansion or the compound. And Cap's like, come on, Tony. And he's like, and I understand Cap, where he's coming from. But at the same time, I understand Tony because he's like, well, excuse me, but Scarlet Witch is not an American citizen. And they're just not giving visas to weapons of mass destruction. I mean, you can't argue with Iron Man right there. And you can't argue with Cap either. I mean, it's just, I'm loving the conflict as it's building up. I mean, these guys are still friends, of course, or acquaintances, teammates, whatever you want to call it, a combination of three. But I'm just loving the dialogue and the valid reasons as to why there are opposing sides. And I don't know if you noticed this, but I have a Spider-Man in the middle, and I got, oh, you know what? The hell am I doing? I was trying to, I messed my setup. I was trying to have Spider-Man in the middle, and then all Iron Man on this side, and all Cap on this side, but anyway, you can't even see, well, it doesn't matter, but where was I? I lost my train of thought. No, you really understand where these guys are coming from, both sides. Especially with the hey, she's not an American citizen, man. I mean, you know, she's blowing up things and, you know, like, oh, and something else. I want to go back to the Thunderbolt Ross scene earlier. I really do like that he was like, Thunderbolt Ross, even though I didn't like that scene, I do like he said, okay, hey, do you know where Thor and the Hulk are right now? And nobody could say anything, because they don't know. And he's like, well, yeah, I wonder how people would react if I just misplaced a few megaton nuclear warheads. Good point there, sir. I can't argue with you there. You have a valid point there, Mr. Thaddeus Thunderbolt Ross. But anyway, back to the, you know, where Bucky's about to break out. He breaks out and he kills people. He kills people. And that just gives Iron Man's team more of a reason. Like, dude, I understand that this dude was brainwashed, but we still can't just let him go out willy-nilly and do whatever the hell he wants. If he's brainwashed, we need to capture him and stop him so he won't do this anymore. I mean, we know it's not his fault, but we still cannot let him just go do whatever the hell he wants. But anyway, next we have Bucky trying to break out of there, and then all of the Avengers are trying to fight him, and Iron Man doesn't have his suit, but he has a little wristwatch thing, and I like that. And Sharon Carter and Black Widow and Black Panther all come over there and try to give him their two cents of beating his ass or whatever. And when it was, I love the tag teaming. And when it was Winter Soldier versus Black Panther, he punches him in the chest and Black Panther seemed like he lost. He was like, nah, man, you're not finna get away from me again. And he runs and jumps up and then he sweeps him and Bucky flips over the guardrail and he disappears. And then that's basically just, you know, the end of that fight and they disappear. So, Winter Soldier goes up and he's trying to get in the helicopter. And that scene was fun. And I liked the music of how when they had Cap actually bringing in the helicopter. But at the same time, I know Cap is strong, but it just kind of seemed unrealistic to me. I mean, I don't buy somebody running and hanging on a helicopter and able, like, while your legs are dangling, you're able to bring it down. I don't know. I really didn't buy that, and that's a nitpick, and just one of the small reasons why I can't give this movie a perfect 10. Well, you know, that, and then the giant subtitles, and then, well, I'm not going to knock it for the casting of T'Chaka. But, yeah, I didn't buy that, but anyway, they go down there. I mean, they're fighting, and Captain America destroys the helicopter, almost gets his head freaking cut off, and they crash into the water, and then the next scene we get is when his Winter Soldier's arm is in that vice and Captain America and Falcon come in there and trying to talk to him. Cap's like, hey, which Bucky is this? And he's like, hey, you know, your mom's name is Sarah. You used to put a newspaper in your shoes. And, you know, Bucky is coming back. So, loving all of that. And now we get to the recruitment part where they're going around and recruiting. And Black Widow is just like, hey, you know, I know somebody that can help. Because Thunderbolt Ross gives him 36 hours. And they're like, hey, what's going to be different? He's like, I am not going to be in some loafers in a three-piece suit. I'm going to have a suit. He asks for 72 hours, he gets 36, and she's like, hey, I can go get Black Panther, because they're like, we're understaffed. She's like, well, I know somebody downstairs, and she's really talking about Black Panther. He's like, oh, I know somebody too, and we found out a little bit later, they're talking about Spider-Man. But then they switch over to Captain America and all of them, and Captain America and the Falcon, they go get Ant-Man, or whatever, and then Hawkeye goes and recruits Scarlet Witch from freaking the compound that's being held down by Vision or whatever. And I skipped the scene and I want to go back. I think it was right after an action scene, some type of action, to where it cuts over and Vision is like, oh yes, a pinch of paprika. That was funny and I laughed. And I love the dynamic between Scarlet Witch and Vision. Vision is putting down that game. He got that mouthpiece talking about, I just want people to see the world to see you as I do. He didn't say sweetheart. I'm like, look at your Vision. You know what I'm saying? Keep doing what you're doing, man. You're going to be in there. And if you think I'm being a pervert, I am not. Read your freaking comic books and catch up on your knowledge, because it still doesn't make sense to me. But yeah, if you know the story, Vision and Scarlet Witch, they end up being a couple. I don't know if Vision actually ended up becoming a human by, from the 7-star Dragon Balls, and they wish him to a human. And that's a Dragon Ball Z joke that I just made. If you watch Dragon Ball Z, you know about Android 18 and Krillin. You know exactly what I'm talking about. I don't think Vision does that. But in the comics, Vision and Scarlet Witch has twins. How this is possible, I don't know. And it's just the story behind it is just so freaking weird, because they have babies in the comics, but then the twins are not really twins. They're like reincarnated demons from Mephisto, and then later on Mephisto absorbs the babies back in, and Scarlet Witch loses her mind and she just goes ape shit because of that. I mean, I imagine any woman would do that if you birth children, but then you find out they're demons, and it's really weird. And every time I hear this stuff, I'm like, what? If I have it wrong, let me know in the comments below. But anyway, I do love Vision and Scarlet Witch's relationship. But jumping back to the recruiting, because it's at the compound where Scarlet Witch and Vision are there. And Hawkeye sets off some device or explosion as a distraction. Oh, excuse me. And he comes in the back way and he's like, hey, we got to go. And if anybody were to say, whether you know comics or you don't, if you know these characters or not, and someone were to say, hey, who are we in Scarlet Witch, Hawkeye or Vision, everybody would be like, duh, of course, Vision. I mean, he's a freaking vibranium android with an infinity gem or stone in his forehead. Hawkeye shoots arrows. But they still made them fight. And even though it was no contest, I was still thoroughly entertained. And I mean, he shot the arrows over here and over there. And I love that we're each MCU movie, we get to see new types of arrows that Hawkeye has built or that Tony Stark has helped him create. So keep doing that, Marvel. I love that, you know, you just keep elevating and upgrading the characters. Just like Iron Man is always updating his suit, you know, Hawkeye is always updating his arrows, etc. So I like how he set the trap for Vision, but Vision did his little phasing trick and he was out. And he was shooting arrows and trying to hit him with arrows and kicking them, and it was just like, you know, Vision is just blocking it like a G. Huh, huh, psh, psh, and he's taking hits. Psh, psh, psh. Get out the way, Clint. You cannot overpower me. And then Scarlet, he's like, no. He's like, ah, no, I can't, but she can. And then Scarlet Witch coming over there doing all of her little stuff like that. And I love that. And then she just like blasts his ass with the boom, 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 down like 15 floors. And I'm loving all that. And she could have just blasted him down, but the way she was doing it, it has so much dramatic effect. Like, it was really hurting the Vision. He was like, just going down. And like, I mean, he really, like, he was in pain. And I'm just like, yeah. And she's like, look, I don't want to kill you, but get out of my way. I want to leave. If you do this, I forgot the rest of the words, but it was epic and I liked it. And and Hawkeye's over there knocked out, and then you know, they leave or whatever. But then we get to see Tony Stark go to Queens to pick up Spider-Man, Peter Parker, Tom Holland. Now, a lot of people may be complaining. I don't know why you would complain, but this is a different version of Aunt May that is in the comics. She came across as a grandma figure. And guys, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. You see the Captain America shirt. You see the, all the comic book backgrounds and whatnot. But to be honest with you, I've probably in my entire life only read maybe one or two comic books. So you may say, well, Brandon, why do you love this material so much? Why do you have the pearl? Why do you have the decorations? Why do you love these characters? Well, because I fell in love with the characters during like the 90s with the cartoons and the video games and all that good stuff. And when does I love Spider-Man so much is from that 90s cartoon. I love that cartoon. I mean, like, oh my gosh, it was one of my favorite things as a child. But during that time, I was always just saying to myself, why does Aunt May always look like a grandmother? Well, they addressed that in this film, and we have Marissa Tomei as the hot Aunt May. And she was looking pretty good. Not my type, but she was still looking pretty hot. I don't even use that word hot. They used it in the movie. That's why I used that. But she was looking good. But anyway, I love this scene. We get Tom Holland as Peter Parker, Spider-Man, coming in. And I loved how, you know, they were playing on each other with the grant and, or whatever. And then they go into the room. And I loved that whole scene. It was amazing. It was, you know, Peter Parker, he doesn't know what's going on. He's trying to be discreet and hide it. But Tony's not stupid. He got videos off of YouTube. And Now, I didn't realize this the first time. But I did the second time. And it bothered me slightly. And I'm not going to bring the film down for this, but when General Thaddeus Thunderbolt Ross gave Iron Man 36 hours to bring in Captain America and his team, Team Cap, I don't know where they were in the world, but I know they wasn't in Queens. So, Tony, well, I wasn't as, but the point that I was trying to get at is that how was Iron Man able to build Spider-Man's suit within 36 hours? I mean, I know the guy is freaking smart, but Spider-Man had his suit at the airport scene. And I think at that time, I think Iron Man said to Cap, like, hey, Thaddeus gave me 36 hours to find you and bring you in. And that was 10 hours ago. So did he make Spider-Man suit in like 12 hours? Mind you, he has to fly around the country and stuff to recruit him. I don't know. There may be a little, I mean, it's not a big deal. It didn't ruin the movie for me, but I did notice. I'm just thinking like, okay, how did you fly over there, fly over here, building the suit and all of that, you know, within that amount of time? But anyway, not going to harp on it too much, but when I saw the first trailer where Spider-Man was revealed, when it was like, hello, everyone, and they showed the little zooming in on the eyes and stuff, I was turned off. I really didn't like that costume. And then I was reading comments, seeing the opinion of everyone else. Some people hated it. Some people loved it. Oh, this is the classic Spider-Man back in the day where his eyes was big. And they gave him the reason why they did that is they wanted to pay homage to that, pay respect to that, also give him zooming eyes. But I liked that the dialogue, they were like, man, I'm at 44 minutes. I like in the dialogue, they were like, hey, when I got my powers 6 months ago, and I do like that they kept it at 6 months, Peter Parker said my senses have been souped up to 11. And everything is just taken in, so I wear these goggles, you know, to kind of tone it down. So I like that Tony Stark was able to build him some goggles to do that. And when that was nice or whatever, you know, that was actually awesome or whatever. So, I mean, I was just loving that dialogue, and he was like, don't tell Aunt May. And he shot he used his mechanical web shooters and shot the door. And Tony Stark's making jokes like, you know, get me out of this. And, you know, all of that. I love the scene. It was a great scene. It was a great introduction to Peter Parker. But then, guys, right after that, we get to see Captain America, Winter Soldier, and the Falcon pull up, and they meet Sharon Carter, Hawkeye, and Ant-Man. All that is funny. It's been in the previews. Hey, we're beyond law on this one. So if you try to come with us, you're a wanted man. He's like, hey, you know, what else is new? And I love that. And I love the dialogue between Cap and Sharon, and they kiss. No, before that, I love the scene where the line where Winter Soldier's in the bed. Hey, can you move your seat up? I mean, that doesn't even belong in this movie, but it fits so well. And that's just a real life thing. I mean, that's just the last thing that I would be thinking about in a superhero movie. But I mean, they driving around in a car, this little hubbub. And he's uncomfortable back there, just like, damn, man. Can you move your seat? It's just a funny real life moment that everybody can relate to by sitting in the back seat, and it's a good tension breaker. I mean, it's just perfect. I mean, so thank you guys for just putting that in. And another scene is when they make out right in front of Falcon and Winter Soldier, and they just looking just like, and then guys do stuff like that, like, yeah, man. You know, they didn't say that, just like, yeah, you know. It was hilarious. I think that part right there was one of the funniest things in the entire movie, or to my experience, people laughed a lot during that scene right there. But hey, right after that, guys, they're like, yeah, suit up. And they put the suits on and like, hey, we got a helicopter over here. And they're running over to the helicopter, and it's the airport scene, the best scene in any movie ever created. But anyway, they got the airport scene, and they're trying to run to the helicopter, and Iron Man shoots some device to disable it. And then Iron Man comes down there with his superhero landing. Ding, ding, all the sound effects. War Machine comes down there. Ding, ding. And all his weapons and stuff are moving around and all that stuff like that. And then it's just the first initial face-off. And they try to do it with words. And Iron Man's pissed off, like, hey, enough is enough. You got to come with me right now. Stand down. I'm sick of this. You're getting on my nerve. And Cap is like, man, I don't want to listen to you. Move out the way. And I think at that point in time, that's when Black Panther comes down. And, of course, Underoos and Spider-Man comes and steals the shield. And he's just, like, really geeking out and excited. Like, man, like, I when I was in junior elementary and junior high, I remember, you know, okay, so Tom Holland in this role is, he's like 15 or 16-year-old high school student. So when Iron Man first announced himself, he's like 7, 8 years old. And then he's seeing the Avengers 4 years ago on TV, all these superheroes. And now like he's a part of it. He's just geeking out like, oh, hey, Iron Man, you know, thanks for calling me. I hope I do good, man. You know, don't go too hard on me. Hey, Cap, I'm a big fan. Hello. You know, I mean, he's acting really like a teenager would act, like a fan would act. He's like geeking out in the middle of a battle. I mean, and that's perfect. And they're like, dude, calm down. And he just can't help it. But then the fight starts, and we find out that Ant-Man has been hiding in the shield the whole. We don't know where he is. It doesn't really matter. He may have been in there the whole time. But Cap throws his arms up, and Hawkeye shoots the arrow, and it breaks. And it is just the best piece of entertainment that has ever graced the screen before. And it is just so entertaining. And every character nearly fights everybody. I mean, I think I got this written down. I mean, you got Black Panther versus Captain America, Spider-Man versus Bucky and Falcon, Iron Man versus Scarlet Witch and Hawkeye, because Hawkeye was shooting arrows. He's like, oh, it made you look, or it made you miss, or whatever. No, he hit the cars and the cars are falling, and Scarlet Witch is like throwing cars at him, and then Friday comes in like multiple contusions, and you know that. And another thing, when Spider-Man was fighting Bucky and Falcon, I mean, that was freaking amazing. I did not watch the clip or the TV spot where Spider-Man caught. That was a surprise to me. And when Spider-Man caught Winter Soldier's fist, I was like, I think I actually yelled out holy shit into the movie, because I mean, that metal arm is so iconic for just being strong and beating the crap out of everybody. And then you have this 15-year-old baby Spider-Man coming and just catching it. It's like, oh my gosh, dude, you have a metal arm. Just like, I mean, that is just, I mean, will make, I don't know, that would just mess me up mentally if just a little teenager is like, oh, cool, metal arm. I mean, I don't know what I would do. And it's just funny. And that whole scene where Spider-Man is like scaling on the walls, and I think like Winter Soldier threw some big door or something at him, and Spider-Man whips it back like, hey, you missed this, and flings it back. And one time he used his spider sense because his back was turned and something was finna come and hit him in the head. And he was like, whoa, and just ducked. And they didn't use the graphics of his spider sense, but that whole thing was just nice. I mean, he whooped up on Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and I loved all that. And Falcon did something, like one of them did something, and the other guy was like, couldn't you do that earlier? And I feel him on that. And he's like, Falcon was like, I hate you. And it was just funny. And I, you know, I love that Spider-Man versus Falcon and the Winter Soldier. That's something that I just never thought I would see in my entire life. And then something else is that that's badass in there is that they had Scarlet Witch versus Ant-Man for a while. And she's has the upper hand on him, and he shrinks down and flips her. Then they switch over into a, like, little view showing little Ant-Man running, like, tossing her, and then, like, she shocks him, and he flies into a door. I mean, just stuff like I said, it's just things that I never thought I would see before. Then you got Ant-Man coming there with a little truck, like, hey, throw this at this, and, you know, that's funny. I mean, this whole thing, this whole scene at the airport, I'm taking it seriously, and there are real stakes there. The only person trying to kill somebody is Black Panther is trying to kill the Winter Soldier. But everybody else, they're just trying to stop them from getting into the helicopter or getting into the Quinjet and flying away. And just another thing is Iron Man is like flying through the air, blowing up small planes. I don't even know if I noticed that the first time, but he's like going through blowing up vehicles of transportation vehicles, whether it's a car, plane or whatever. So nobody can escape. And it was real smart that they evacuated the airport and just all of that. And then, you know, they're fighting, and then Vision just comes in there like a boss, just blasting the line in the cement. Children, what are you doing? Stop this. You're acting crazy. I mean, he had an epic, like, Superman type entrance or whatever. He's beaming the hell out of the cement, drawing a line in the ground, you know, floating in the air with his cape flat flapping or whatever. And then that's where you get the two sides. You get the Iron Man side versus the Captain America side. And they're doll, and they just like, no, we're getting out of here. And they come, and Spider-Man's making jokes and stuff, talking about, oh, they're not stopping. And it's funny. And then you just get this epic clash of heroes beating the crap out of each other. And then something that I just love so much was when they showed all the characters, like three or four sets of characters, and the camera is zooming in like this, showing these two people beating up, and then it skips over them, and then showing these two people going at it, and then skips over them, and showing them just going at it. And I'm just looking at this like, oh my God, this is like a freaking dream come true. And I'm just loving it, just sitting there, just awe and amazement. And then all of a sudden, Ant-Man becomes Giant Man. And like, what's crazy about it is he's just like, okay, guys, I'm going to try something. We need a distraction. Everybody and like some Falcon is like, okay, everybody's, I think Falcon and Hawkeye was like, okay, everybody's not gonna like make it out of here or something, you know. Cap, you know, you and Winter Soldier are gonna have to go on, but we need a distraction. And man comes in there like, all right, I'm gonna try this. I tried it before in a lab, and it worked, but only for a little bit. But I may rip myself in half, but if I do, tell somebody I love him or something. And they're like, is he gonna rip himself in half? And then he gets big, and it's like Ant-Man just turned into Giant Man, and he's geeking out on his own ability. And he just get big. He's like, oh, ho, 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 look what I can do. And he's like hanging on the War Machine. And Spider-Man's like, holy shit. And Giant Man is like acting like that too. Like, man, I can't believe it worked for a second time. And I think Iron Man is like, give me back my friend. And then I'm just like loving it. And Vision is to the side, not really wanting to get into the fight, and because he is more mature, and he just like, he's only getting involved in the fight when he actually needs to. And Cap and America's team just got Giant Man. He can slap people around, so he wants to come into the fight too. And he turns hard and like blast, you know, like runs his head into his chest or whatever. And at one point, a Giant Man backfists War Machine, and he's flying and finna fall into a plane. Spider-Man's webs and saves him and webs him back, and then War Machine gains itself and is flying off, but Spider-Man is webbed onto him. And then we get shots of like a War Machine flying through the air with Spider-Man hanging on the back of him like their teammates while he's webbing and kicking people. And I'm just sitting there just like looking like, wow, this is just ridiculous. I can't believe that they choreographed all of this. I mean, I literally never thought I would see this in my life. I mean, I'm just giddy loving it. And like, while War Machine is flying with Spider-Man hanging onto him, that's in the forefront, but in the background, you had like Giant Man and Vision fighting each other. So it's just crazy framing on court. I mean, gosh, I'm getting a headache just trying to explain it. Not a good headache. I'm just thinking about the headache that they had trying to choreograph all this and keeping pace, you know, with it all. But then right after that, we get freaking Captain America versus Spider-Man. And it was a good even fight. I mean, Spider-Man was whooping up on them first, going after his feet. And then Captain America was flipping around, bringing him in and kicking him and throwing this. And Spider-Man making jokes like, hey, man, your shield is, excuse me, your shield is defying the laws of physics. And that's funny because, and you buy it because some of the stuff that Cap was doing with the shield, I'm like, nah, how the hell did he do that with the shield? But I don't really care too much. I mean, vibranium is a fictional metal anyway, so who knows what the hell it could do. I mean, it's a comic book movie in the real world. And I love that. And as they're fighting, they're having dialogue, and Spider-Man's like, look, Iron Man told me that you would be bad, and da-da-da. Well, Iron Man could have told you anything, kid. Captain America didn't say that, but I'm thinking about it. But he's easily influenced, you know, by Iron Man. The guy's a freaking billionaire. So I know the guy knows what he's talking about somewhat. So, I mean, I love that. And then Cap does something, and he throws the shield and makes the airport thing fall on him. And you see how strong Spider-Man is from being bitten by a radioactive spider. And it's just amazing to me because this is bait. Because when Spider-Man grows up, he should be able to kick Batman's ass, Captain America's ass. And Spider-Man has his own type of martial arts, like Spider-Fu or something. Spider sense, incredible agility and all this. When he gets, you know, this is baby Spider-Man, so the fights are kind of even. But when he gets older, he should be able to beat Captain America's butt. But I like how they kept it contained here or whatever. But then it's so funny just jumping back over to Vision, and he flies into Ant-Man's chest or whatever. And Ant-Man, oh, something flew into me. And he's like freaking out. And I wouldn't know. I'd be freaking out too. Like, ah, what's going on? And it's funny. And they have all these funny comedic elements and these funny moments in a battle, and it's not weighing it down. I mean, it's able to work. I mean, I guess because I didn't like it at the Age of Ultron because the world was at stake. Okay, the world is not at stake here. They're just trying to stop them from leaving. But it works. And then Scarlet Witch is, you know, and then we got another fight. It's Black Panther versus Hawkeye. And Hawkeye's like, hey, we haven't met. You know, I'm this guy. I'm a Hawkeye. Black Panther catching arrows like it ain't shit. It's like, I don't care. I love that. And then another part, we got Hawkeye diving behind boxes, shooting arrows, and Iron Man is blasting the arrows out the sky. I mean, I could go on. I feel like I'm just leaving so much out, and I want to cover so much. And I'm just loving every moment of it. I mean, it's just so ridiculously entertaining. And then Scott, like, I think a part after this, Black Panther catches up with Bucky Barnes again. He's about to, like, you know, get him with that Ninja Vibranium Death Panther Wakandan grip. And Scarlet Witch from a distance uses her abilities and stops him and flings him over here. And then somebody else is about to kick him, somebody else. And Scarlet Witch catches him with her powers and flings him over here. And then Bitch is like, I'm sick of this crap. And uses this beam and tries to cut the tower in half with his special beam powers or whatever. And Scarlet Witch is like, no. And uses her powers or whatever and stops the thing. And I'm just like, oh my gosh. All these characters are using like all their abilities like at the same time. And then Scarlet Witch, she's trying to hold the watchtower so that Winter Soldier and Cap can get away. But then a War Machine comes with some audio device and blasting Scarlet Witch. And she can't do her thing anymore or whatever. And then they get away. And then Black Widow's right there just posted up the whole time. Just like, which is kind of smart. Okay, this is the only transportation device. I'm just going to sit here as a last resort. But she's like, look, Cap, you're not going to stop, man. He's like, no, I'm not going to stop, man. This is my homeboy right here. Shit, we 100 years old, whatever. And so Black Panther's behind, and she starts shooting Black Panther. And now this kind of did bother me, though. Because, I mean, I like Black Widow, but with a vibranium suit, are we really saying that Black Widow could stop Black Panther? Because, I don't know. I mean, I don't have a problem with her stopping him. But it's just like, I mean, say for instance, Black Widow was just a bad guy or something. You know, well, I was going to say that she could shock him and while he's like, oh, God, I can't move. You know, she can shoot him, but bullets they don't even ricochet. They just bounce off. They don't bounce off. They just fall to the ground. It's okay. I wasn't too thrilled with Black Widow being able to stop Black Panther. Black Widow. It's just a nitpick, you know. But, I mean, that's pretty much... Well, no, it's not the end of the fight. You know, they fly off and... Vision comes over there to help his baby, like, you know, and he loses his concentration, like Scarlet Witch, like, oh my God, he's like, I'm sorry. She's like, I'm sorry too. And it's like, you know, I don't know, they just have some chemistry together. And then, you know, Captain and Bucky are flying off, and Iron Man, Falcon, and War Machine are chasing. And War Machine's like, hey man, I got something on my back. And Vision loses concentration because he's thinking about Scarlet Witch and just throws out a blast. And we get to, and War Machine goes crashing down and just, you know, breaks his back damn near. And I'm just like, wow, you know, that's pretty crazy. And it's just pretty sad. But just one of the best action scenes in the world. And I loved it, guys. I loved it. Well, all right, guys. I've been talking for nearly over an hour. And I'm about to sum it up. We get to the last scene. And we get to and this is the part where the first time, I didn't care for it. But the second time, I liked it a lot more, and it made sense to me. There's still something that doesn't make sense. But so we know. So, of course, all the heroes, you know, they get locked up. They go over to the raft, and they got the underwater, under ocean prison. And Iron Man finds out where they're going, and they go to the secret base where they're having all the other Winter Soldiers. And about that. To me, and I guess I could do my research, it's not entirely clear if Bucky has the Super Soldier Serum in him or maybe a degree of it. Now, I may not know what I'm talking about or need to do more research, but I don't know how I'm just so happy with them being multiple Winter Soldiers. And, you know, we found out that not Tony Stark, his father, Anthony. He had like 5 vials of that Super Soldier Serum 2 and gave it to the other Super Soldiers. And I mean, that's fine. But so let's talk about Zemo's plan here. So we find out that Zemo had his family in Sokovia. He felt that they were miles away from the battle. And apparently they were not far away. And his family dies. Through the movie, he's listening to a voice recording of his wife saying, hey, you know, come try to make it to the dysfunction of your son. He wants to see you, blah, 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 blah. Initially, I did not know that was a voice message. I just thought he was on the phone. The second time, after Black Panther stopped him from shooting himself in the head, I realized it was a message, and it just hit home for me even more as to why Zemo is sad and wants to destroy the Avengers, because he just pissed off the collateral damage and just doesn't know about the best way to, you know, cope. But earlier in the film, we found out that when S.H.I.E.L.D. failed a few years ago, when Black Widow released the secret Hydra S.H.I.E.L.D. files out to the public, it was millions of files, millions of pages, a lot of it was decrypted. He had the patience and the experience to decode it, and he found out that Winter Soldier was the very reason why Tony's parents were dead. But what's stupid to me, well, before I tell you what's stupid, and help me out in the comments if his plan makes more sense. So he says that, hey, I know I cannot physically beat you guys, and a empire that is defeated by its enemies can always rise again, and I want you guys to stay crushed. But an empire falling from within, that is dead, so I want you guys to kill each other. Well, when he showed up to the base, he did not know that those soldiers were dead or not, because that was his first time there. So I'm assuming that he went there to wake them up, to either so he can control them at his bidding, or he can wake them up so by the time Captain and all them get there that he can make them fight or whatever. But if that was his plan, setting his super soldiers against each other, setting other Winter Soldiers against the Avengers, that's just going to bring the Avengers together. So that really doesn't make sense to me. But he finds out that they are dead. Now, let's say that he knew that they were dead. why meet there? If you want to show them the video of Winter Soldier killing Tony's parents, and that doesn't. And another thing that doesn't make sense to me within that is because at the beginning of the film, when Winter Soldier was being brainwashed, and he said, "Okay, extraction, no witnesses." I just don't buy that on a road like that, that there is a camera on an old dirt country road. Why is there a camera there in the first place to capture that footage? Another thing that I did not like is it's just so coincidental that the car crash of Tony's parents happened right in front of the camera. Another thing that does not make sense is in the Captain America Winter Soldier, when Winter Soldier was doing his missions, or I assumed he was, he always had the mask on. He didn't have the mask on during that scene when he's trying to be incognito. Excuse me. If he did and I'm wrong, I apologize. Let me know. But he didn't have his mask on, so you're showing yourself on camera. And another thing is, if you knew the camera was there because you shot it, why don't you shoot it out even before you killed them? So it just shows a crash and then the camera going out. So another thing is, it's like, who had that footage anyway? I mean, I don't know. Like, that this, it doesn't, like, whose camera was that? Who set it up? Was it the city, the state? You know, if so, was that feed live? I mean, back in the 1990s when that happened, did Hydra infiltrate whoever camera there was and kill everybody? If so, why didn't you delete the video? I don't know. It just, all this is just not making sense to me. But so the first time I saw it, when Tony Stark is watching it, I'm just like, okay, Zemo, if you knew the soldiers were dead because they died in their sleep, or you killed them because it may have looked like they had a bullet hole in the head, you know, why did you have to lead them all the way out here to show Tony Stark the video to piss him off, to get him to attack Winter Soldier, Captain America? You could have just emailed it to him, or I don't know, mailed a DVD to his house or whatever. And I don't know. So when Tony was looking at the video, and he was, of course, distraught and losing all types of reason, which makes sense. You just saw your mom and dad get brutally murdered by the guy that is standing right in front of you. Okay, I don't mind if you lose your shit and want to kill him. And the first time I saw the movie, when he was like, "Cap," and "Cap, did you know?" And he's like, "Yeah, you know, yeah, he knew," and it pissed him off. So they gave him a reason to not. They gave him a reason to fight Bucky, but when they were like that last fight scene in this corridor, I break it up into two parts. The first part is the initial start of the fight, and the second part is, you know, when they're trying to go up the thing and Iron Man shoots the door and it falls down and they fall down. The second part of that fight is when this trailer showed Captain America and Winter Soldier teaming up on Iron Man. That's part two of the fight for me and how I break it down. The first time I saw the movie, I really wasn't feeling part one because I couldn't really buy a reason why Captain was so mad why Iron Man was so mad at Captain America. But I saw the film the first time a few weeks ago during the breakup the first and second time. I saw Captain America, the First Avenger, and I saw Winter Soldier again, and just because I wanted to watch it in anticipation of seeing it again. And when Black Widow and Captain America were underground and they met, not Zemo, but what is his name? The scientist from the first one. And I forgot his name, but he was in the computer when he was like, Hydra's been around for 7 years, and he's like, prove it. They were showing news clippings of when he was like, when people didn't cooperate, you know, Hydra made changes, and they showed that Winter Soldier killed Tony's parents and that thing. So that's the reveal. I didn't remember that the first time I saw it, but going into the second time I realized this. So it made more sense to me the second time why Iron Man was so mad at Captain America. And so I enjoyed both parts of that scene, just lovely, and it was choreographed great. And just something in the second part, it was just so epic to me. And the Russos, like they said in so many interviews, they are just such fans of this type of material. And they were just giving you so many comic book moments of just them tag teaming on Cap, back fisting and kicking and punching here and throwing the shield back and forth. And then, you know, you're thinking that they're about to just whoop on Captain America in the trailers, but you see that eventually Iron Man blasts Cap over here and he flies back. And then it's Iron Man and Winter Soldier over here one-on-one. And Winter Soldier just knocks him in the thing and into the wall and is about to rip out his arc reactor, and he just like F that and just unibeams the shit out of his arm and blast it off. I'm like, hell yes, I want to see that in Infinity War, and that those names are going to change. I want to actually just, they may not do it because it doesn't make sense to, but I want to actually hear Iron Man just yell out, unibeam, and he blasts out of his chest and he's like walking like black. Oh gosh, I'll lose my, I'll probably piss myself in the theater if I see that in the movie. But but as Winter Soldier and Iron Man are fighting, they're just like boom, 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 boom. And he like blocks him and he tries to shoot his repulsor out. And it's just blast like beam and like going all over the ceiling. And then Captain America comes back in there. And it's just like, you know, like blast, blast, blast. And then you get that one iconic scene where Iron Man blasts his beams and Captain America puts down his shield and it just freezes. And you're looking at the picture right now because I just put it up. And it's just like, I'm just looking at that. I'm just like, yes, 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 yes. Oh, you know, and it's just like, just magical. I mean, just like, I mean, just a dream come true. Everything that I'm just looking for in this movie. And I'm just loving it, loving it, loving it, loving it, loving it, loving it. And then, we see shots of Black Panther out there with Zemo, and he's like, you know, almost, you know, killed the wrong man, and these people, everybody's, you know, being led by vengeance, and I don't want to be, you know, like that anymore, but you're still going to pay. And he tries to kill himself, and, you know, and I think that Zemo may have lost, and I'll tell you why later. I lost on purpose, and I'll tell you why later of my theories of what's to come next. And if you watched Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes, that lovely cartoon that they had that came out years ago, not Avengers Assemble where everything is whack and hunky-dory, you'll understand my theory that I'm about to give in a moment. And I'm like 1 hour and 14 minutes. But then we cut back and Captain America and Iron Man are just beating the shit out of each other, and Captain America is winning, and Fridays is like, you can't win hand in hand. He's like, analyze this fight pattern. And then, you know, Iron Man comes in there and beating the shit out of him. And Cap is like, I can do this all day. He's like, stand down. And I just love that Bucky was knocked out, grabs his arm. Iron Man comes over there and kicks him in the face with an iron boot, knocks him out. Captain America, F that. Comes over, like, how is that Iron Man over his head? Body slams him down on that crack. Beating the crap out of him. Here's my shield. Beating him. I'm like, damn, you are really about to kill this guy. Knocks his helmet off. Blood all over. I'm just like, wow, you are going to decapitate this guy. And comes down with the shield on the arc reactor. And I'm just like, whoa, man. Like, these guys here just, you know. I mean, Cap won the fight. Cap was not trying to kill Iron Man. But I really feel like Iron Man just did not really care at that point. And you know, the one of them almost could have died. And I love it where, you know, Iron Man lost, Cap won, and Cap don't want to fight no more. Iron Man doesn't either. He's just like, man, this is crazy. And Iron Man just still talking crap like, man, that is not your shield. You don't deserve that shield. My father built that shield. And, you know, technically he did. It's not his shield. His father did build it. And Cap is just tired. He's just like, man, F it, man. You can have the shield. Just like, take the shield. You know, I don't care. And yeah, man, and it ends, and it's just it's great. And you know what happens after that? I really don't remember. But you know, the movie comes to an end. You know, there's dialogue here and dialogue there, and it's just a great scene. A great movie, great ending. You know, I loved it. You know, and it really sucks that War Machine, Rhodey, is paralyzed. Well, not paralyzed, but hurt. You know, he barely can walk. His spine is destroyed. And, you know, we get to the end and, you know, Captain America mails Captain America. Iron Man mails Captain America a FedEx phone. And we get to see Stan Lee out there talking about Tony Stank. And that's just funny. And, you know, we get that last little piece of dialogue, that voiceover just saying, hey, man, I know we have our differences, but and I think you can understand where I'm coming from. If you need me, I'm here. And he leaves the phone right there. And I like that they didn't just in the movie, you know, Iron Man, my bad, bro. We good. You know, I'm glad that they really do. You know, they just make them enemies, but, you know, there's still some problems that need to be worked out, and I like the way they ended that. And if you stay for the mid-credit scene, you get to see the Black Panther and is holding Bucky in Wakanda. So, Sebastian Stan, Bucky Barnes, the Winter Soldier, has 9 films under his contract belt with Marvel. And we've seen him 3 times. So I think it's pretty safe to assume that the Winter Soldier is going to be in Black Panther. I think it's pretty safe to assume that. You know, he got 6 films left. You know, why not? And, you know, we get that was a mid-credit scene. I can't wait for Black Panther. God, that character was so freaking awesome. And then, you know, the end credit scene is with Spider-Man with his web shooter playing around with the red light. And I'll be honest with you, I love that 90s cartoon, but I don't know anything about that red light. I was like, what is it? I mean, I don't care about spoiling mid-credit scenes. So So the first time I saw the movie, there was no mid-credit. I mean, there was no end credit scenes. They do that. They only, if there's multiple scenes, they'll only show like one or something, but when the movie officially comes out, they'll show the Spider-Man one. I mean, the extra one. So I saw the Spider-Man one for the first time, the second time I saw the whole movie. And but before I saw it the second time, I went to Clever Movies YouTube channel because they had a 2 or 3 minute video about the ending. And I went in knowing that, but I was like, I don't know nothing about no Spider-Man with a red light. So if you're watching this in the comments, you know, let me know what all that's about, because I don't remember that from the 90s cartoon. I'm sure it was there in the comments, but I just don't know it. But guys, I love the freaking movie to death. Oh my gosh, I loved it even better the second time. Even though I was disappointed with Zemo the first time, I like him a lot more, because I realized that, you know, it's still some things that just don't add up with, you know, them meeting there at the end, but it was a great film. I'm still keeping this film at a 9.5 out of 10 because I loved it. This is the best superhero comic book movie ever. This is not the best movie ever, but it has the best action in any movie ever. I will take that to the grave until something else surpasses it. The main thing is you got all these characters fighting each other, and they actually had a rhyme. They actually had a reason. They actually had plot story elements that actually made it make sense to why they were fighting each other. And it wasn't just fist blowing for no reason. They was actually trying to use words, dialogue, and legal matters. And in the end, you know, I don't believe in... I mean, I don't like fighting myself. I'll try not to fight. But fighting is, if it comes down to that and we got to throw blows, hey, we got to throw blows. But I'm always trying to resolve it with words. And that movie and this film did that in so many ways and just gave you so many different perspectives that I forgot to mention earlier, which I mentioned in my non-spoiler review of. I mean, they were showing Hulk jumping through buildings, but at the same time, he was knocking concrete on people, killing them. And so, I mean, you can't get mad at that people. There was a lot of collateral damage in all these MCU films. And so, I mean, there's valid reason. Each side has a strong, valid reason why they feel the way they do. And so that just goes to great writing, great storytelling, great directing, great everything by Marvel, Disney, the Russo brothers, costume, the effects, everybody that had to do with everybody. Thank you so much for this picture. It was amazing. I love it. I'm gonna go see the movie tomorrow, Saturday, for a third time, and probably won't see it Sunday for a fourth time, but the weekend after that I'll probably go see it again. And you know, I may be done after that, but I may want to see it a fifth time, because I saw it in regular standard form. I saw it in real IMAX, not that fake bullcrap live shit IMAX that they try. Because IMAX is 3 things. It's sound, it's the best resolution, and it's the size of the screen. A lot of these theaters that be telling you it's IMAX is not the full 70mm IMAX. And that airport scene was filmed with actual IMAX cameras. So when that scene came, it actually expanded. So the first time I saw it, it was in standard. The second time I saw it was in real 70mm IMAX 3D. Right next door to me, I'm just so blessed. I have an AMC theater that has AMC Prime. So I'm going to see it with that maybe tomorrow or something like that after I, you know, edit this video. But I brought up, I'm almost done because I'm at 120 minutes now. If you are an adult, well, this is for you too, but if you are an adult and you want to know more about the Avengers and more about the characters and whatnot, if you have Netflix, I strongly suggest you go put on your list Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes. It's a cartoon that was on the Disney Channel that came out I think in 2010 or 2011, and it was great. It was great storytelling. I was hooked in on every episode. But when the Avengers came out in 2012, they canceled the show because the show had the story had nothing to do with the live action adaptation of the movie. And so because they didn't want people to get confused, they canceled Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes and had a new show called Avengers Assemble. And I don't like Avengers Assemble. It's childish to me. It's all hunky-dory. All the heroes, every Avenger is together as a team in every episode. That wasn't the case in every episode in Earth Mightiest Heroes. They were always, they had a story. They had a reason in the story to why the Avengers kept getting separated around the world. And as you're watching each episode at the edge of your seat, you could not wait until all the characters came back together. And it was actually, I don't want to say it was tailored for adults, but adults can watch it and enjoy it and not feel that this is too kiddie. If you try to watch Avengers Assemble, that cartoon, I just don't recommend it. I can't. I haven't even finished it. It's just too lame and honky-dory to me. But anyway, the reason why I brought up Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes is because there was a story arc with Loki and a lot of the villains and Red Skull and all these other characters that I wouldn't be surprised that when we get Infinity War or what those movies are going to be called, that Zemo, Red Skull, and Loki come back and they team up and also bring in the Masters of Evil. And those are basically like evil Avengers. Because in the Earth Mightiest Heroes, Loki kept fighting the Avengers early on in the seasons and was losing. But we found out at the end of one season that he was losing on purpose to set up stuff. Kind of like, you know how people get, you know, captured on purpose so they can go to prison and, you know, do something. It was kind of like that, but on a such bigger scale. Like in that movie, he got the power of his father, the Odin Force, and he was powerful enough to break Cap's shield. And that would be a perfect story for Infinity War or whatever that movie is going to be called. But I got to end this video, guys. I'm hungry. My goodness, I'm coming over an hour and 20 minutes, but guys, I love this video. So I'm about to say, have you seen it? But if you're watching this video, have you seen, you have seen this movie, Captain America Civil War, and it is amazing. Yes, it is. And if you're still here with me, tell me, what did you rate it? I gave this a 9.5 out of 10, and I still want to stand there. So since you've seen the movie, what did you give it? I mean, do you not care about spoilers? Do you want to see this movie? Have I turned you off? Have I turned you on? Do you agree with me or do you disagree with me? Let me know in the comment section below. Let's get this conversation going and keep it flowing. If you like this video, go ahead and give me the thumbs up. And if you didn't like this video, that's fine. Just leave me a comment below why and still give me the thumbs up. And guys, go ahead and give me a thumbs up. Let's see if we can get this video to 1,500 likes. All right. Since you're watching this video, go ahead and subscribe to my YouTube channel to become one of my subscribers to get all the content that I have to provide in the past and in the future. And also, if you want to find me on any other platforms, you can head over to the website. You can also find me at Instagram and Twitter at justmyopinion84 or at facebook.com/justmyopinion. And guys, share the video. I'm not gonna get mad if you share the video, but thanks guys for tuning in. And before you go, don't forget that my name is Brandon Keith Avery, and this is Just My Opinion. Peace.